Greetings from Jackson Pal Pharmaceuticals Limited. Today, I, Dr. Nitin Tyagi, welcome you to the beginning of our lecture series on Women's Intimate Health by Dr. Ragini Agarwal and Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology. The first of the series is in association with ICOG and AOGD, and the topic of discussion is vaginal discharge. We are indebted to ICOG for assigning one ICOG credit point to all attendees of this series one. We feel privileged to welcome our entire district faculty, Dr. Mandakini Meg, Chairperson ICOG, and Dr. Parag Binniwal, Secretary ICOG. Moderators for case-based panel discussion, Dr. Ragini Agarwal, Clinical Director, W. Pratiksha Hospital, Gurgaon, National Vice President, FOCSI, and President, IACDG, and Dr. Chandan Kachru, Consultant, W. Pratiksha Hospital, Gurgaon, Chairperson, Udan, Harokgain. In the panel are Professor Ashok Kumar, Director, Professor, RML Hospital, New Delhi, Dr. Anita Rajoria, HOD, Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel Hospital, New Delhi, Dr. Mala Srivastav, Senior Consultant, Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi, and President, AOGD. Dr. Neharika Malhotra, Director, Rainbow Hospital, Agra, and Chairperson, FOCSI Committee, YTP. Dr. Shashi L. Kabra Maheshwari, Senior Specialist, DDU, New Delhi, and Dr. Rajasi Sen Gupta, Secretary, Nagpur Obstetrics and Gynecology Society. We welcome all attendees present with us today. Hope all of you enjoy the knowledgeable sharing session. It is a unique webinar where in the audience we have doctors along with the women they care from the society. It may kindly be noted that this session will be streaming on YouTube Live and the recording will remain on the channel for reference and knowledge sharing. I will now request Dr. Ragini Agarwal ma'am to kindly initiate the session.
Thank you, Vibin. I welcome you all panelists, eminent personality from the ICOG. Although Dr. Mandakini Meg not made because of some personal problem, we have Dr. Parag Binniwale and all the delegates who have entered in this unique webinar, first time in the history where the doctors are sharing their medical knowledge with the society for a problem for which the women suffer silently. And even vaginal discharge is such a common thing. It is start from a young adolescent girl to an older woman. Sometime it is a representation of some problem, and most of the time it is nothing but a simple, normal physiological discharge which causes unnecessary stress on the mind of the woman. So I welcome you all. And first I invite Dr. Parag Binniwale, Secretary, Indian College of OBGYN, to say few words from the Indian College of OBGYN, which is a academic wing of FOCSI, the biggest organization of the doctors in whole world. Welcome, Dr. Parag.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ragini. I bring greetings from ICOG, the Indian College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, and it's a pleasure to be associated with this program. So thank you, Dr. Ragini, and thank you, AOGD, for arranging this program today. I really agree with you that this is one area which is not discussed so often, and this is something where women also don't come up in open. So I think it's really important for all of us to understand the smaller details of all these problems. I'll just quickly brief everybody about the Indian College. Indian College was founded in 1984 with a aim to spread knowledge in the field of OBGYN, and now it is working so actively for the last 35 years. We do conduct a lot of academic activities since it is the academic wing of FOCSI. We have certification courses on reproductive medicine, endoscopy, fetal medicine, ultrasound, vaginal surgery, and last but not the least, critical care in obstetrics. And now we've also gone online this year. We have two courses which were conducted online recently. One was on adolescent gynecology and the other was on breastfeeding. And I'm happy to announce that from tomorrow in the evening, we will be having a lecture series on gynecologic oncology, which will go on for next 3 days. So once again, thank you, Dr. Ragini, for having me here and wishing you all the best for your series. Thank you.
Thank you, Parag. Now I will start my panel and just give me a minute to share the screen. To everyone, if you want, especially from the woman from the society who has graciously logged in and sharing this knowledge platform, if you want something from us to change the way we are speaking or anything, please put in the box, chat box. We will take notice of that. Deepika, please see the, those chat. Keep an eye on the chat box permanently.
Right, ma'am.
So I'm starting my panel on the vaginal discharge. I think this is a problem which starts the moment the woman comes in this world. Many a time are two just newly with a newly born, they come in our OPD and say, madam, hamare baby ko red color ka discharge aa raha hai, usko abhi se bleeding shuru ho gayi hai. That is nothing, it is a normal physiological withdrawal of the woman hormone which is supplied to that girl from the mother's body. So it starts from there till the end. So we are here, we are speaking for the silence of the suffering. Many a time they don't discuss, they silently suffer with this. For this, I have my esteemed panel with me, Dr. Ashok Kumar. Dr. Ashok Kumar is a director, professor, RML Hospital, New Delhi, a very learned person, totally dedicated to academy. My another panelist, my very, very dear friend, Anita Rajoria. She's a head of department, another big hospital of Delhi, that is Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Hospital. Dr. Mala Srivastav, all we call Safdarjung, this Sargangaram Hospital, the AIIMS of the private. She is a senior consultant there. And not only that, she is heading the biggest society in the North India, that is Delhi Society of OBGYN AOGD. Now I have a young dynamic gynecologist with us. She is from the Nagpur OBGYN Society. She is the secretary of the society, Dr. Rasi Singh Gupta, and Dr. Shashi Lata Kabra. We called her PPH Lady of North India. She has lots of experience managing the PPH. She is the senior specialty of DGU New Delhi. And in the end, the darling of ours, our second generation, Dr. Niharika Malhotra. Everybody knows her. She is the daughter of two Foxy presidents. She is the director of Rainbow Hospital, chairperson Foxy Kamechi Young Talent Promotion, and we all know for the smiling eyes and the smile on the face. So to start, why we are discussing this vaginal discharge? All cases of vaginal discharge are not caused by sexual transmitted infection and do not need to be treated. This message we want to give to each and every woman. Please don't always afraid of the vaginal discharge. It is other hand, it is a common curable sexually transmitted infections and can present with this symptom in the earlier stages. So third, controlling the spread of sexually transmitted infection and HIV, it is our key public health priorities to worldwide. So it is very, very necessary to understand this vaginal discharge. As a doctor, we should not take it lightly. As a woman, we should not take lightly, but the other hand, we should not also too much worried about it. And all the time, you don't need the treatment for it. Second thing, which is very important, that recent advances are changing investigation techniques and the management of vaginal discharge. Clinicians need to be aware of emerging epidemiological data, the different presentation of the vaginal discharge, and how to approach its management so that the symptom can be treated according to the etiology. Here, Our aim is to provide best of the treatment to our women folk, as vaginal complaints are considered one of the most common reasons that women seek the care of a healthcare provider. Our OPDs, almost, if it is not a specialized OPD like infertility or laparoscopy, in a general OBGYN OPD, almost 40% women, they come with the some or other vaginal discharge related problem. Sorry. So first I will tell what is the physiological vaginal discharge for the benefit of the our end users, that many women have what they perceive as an abnormal vaginal discharge at some point in their lives, but usually it is just a normal physiological discharge. This is white or clear, non-offensive discharge, no itching, no burning, no smell, and it varies with the menstrual cycle, maybe just after menstruation, before menstruation, when you are excited for the sex, mid-cycle. It is absolutely normal to have a vaginal discharge. Sometimes women have a cervical erosion, what doctors tell you, that is a cervical ectopy, and can be associated with a mucoid discharge. And if symptomatic, it is widely treated with a simple treatment by the cryotherapy or diathermy, what we doctor call as a SICAI. So now I start a case, clinical case discussion, and one by one I go to each panelist and they will give the insight of this clinical problem. I will start with an adolescent girl, a 17-year girl present in gynae OPD with her mother with a complaint of vaginal discharge. She has no past medical history of any kind. Even this discharge, she is suffering for first time. And when we talk to any adolescent, it is our duty to take her as an individual. We should not treat her like a child. So we always say the parents, please, can you leave the room for a short while? We will talk to the this adolescent girl. And here, after leaving the mother, she admits that she has an unprotected sex with her boyfriend for the first time 2 weeks ago and complains of a yellow, green, malodorous vaginal discharge, and that starts a week ago. Not only that, she has mild pelvic pain also, and that she has not told these things to the mother. So I will ask Dr. Ashok Kumar, how will you approach this case? What is the key features in the history? What examination is needed? And what test should be done in this woman, this girl? And how you'll manage this case of this adolescent girl? Over to Dr. Ashok Kumar.
Good afternoon, everyone. This actually is a very sensitive issue, especially for adolescent also. And actually she has disclosed that she has a sexual issue. So probably we have to work on those lines now. And if she allows, one can examine her, can do her speculum examination to see the type of discharge basically. Because by looking at the discharge, one can take a lot of information. And if she is not allowing speculum examination, at least one can look at the external genitalia and just separate the discharge coming out of the vagina. And with that nature also, one can find out discharge it is. As we see, probably the discharge seems to be of Trichomonas monalisis, because it is a malodorous green, yellow-green vaginal discharge. But we have to be careful that in these girls, she has sexual intercourse first time and she has mild pain in the abdomen. So one has to look for basically whether she has cystitis also associated, or the discharge or the vaginal infection has gone high, may lead to pelvic inflammatory disease. So with that, actually per speculum examination, and if she allows PV is also important, because then you will find other findings in terms of cervical motion tenderness or tenderness in the fornices. nevertheless, if there, if she is having only infection in terms of vaginal discharge, now we have two options. Either we treat her on the basis of examination finding, or we can subject this discharge to some minimal investigation. And if you look at the discharge, things we can do with the discharge, either we can prepare a wet compression in normal saline. It can be hanging drop also. That will give us so many information. It can show the motile protozoa, that is trichomonas. It can show yeast also. We can also subject discharge to 10% QH solution. That will show IP, fungal lesion, most common malaria acid. And the other thing we can do with the discharge is we can do drum staining also. That will tell us about the flu cell. Or we can see gram-negative diplococci, suggestive of gonorrhea. Or if the field is full of WBC, there is an element of bacterial infection also. And other bedside investigation or the easily available is the pH of the discharge. We can put the pH paper in the vaginal wall and see the pH. If it is alkaline, normally it is acidic. But if it is goes towards bacterial vaginosis or infection, and with that suspicion, one can go for whiff test also, which is a fine test or with the KOH only, 10% the discharge, and if there is a fishy odor, that is suggestive of bacteria. So there are a lot of things we can conclude if we do a little bit test under microscope or pH or gram stain. And simple, another thing is pap smear can also be done. Pap will give you the information about yeast cell or about the protozoa again also under the microscope. And if these things are not conclusive, then one can go for culture also. But I can tell you that culture of vaginal discharge is very tedious job and cumbersome job, because whatever you want to culture, the methodology of taking culture, transporting to the lab, and then doing the culture in that lab depends on the organism, what type of organism you want to look at. If you want to looking for bacterial infection, you have a different thing. If you are going for the fungal infection, then you have to do different way. For gonococci, we have a different method. For chlamydia, we have a different method. So, learn routinely. But if it is a recurrent infection, then one go for culture. Otherwise, cultures are not needed. Only on the basis of these bedside examination of the infection or discharge, one can make a diagnosis that what type of discharge it is. It seems to be trichomoniasis as per the discharge vaginal endings. And the important here again is you treat the partner also. That is important. One has to be very careful and important that you treat the partner. And treatment is usually simple. Metronidazole, you give tablet is there of 400 milligram. You give it for two times or three times a day for 7 days, and same treatment is it's very important that you re-examine the patient after the course of the treatment to see if it has improved or not, discharge has improved or not. If it is not, then you have to go further and do some more investigation, or you have to change the treatment also. Thank you.
So basically, thank you, Dr. Ashok, for giving a very vast discussion in a very short time and in a very crisp way. What is very important here is not to write treatment without examining the patient and at least deciding from which she is suffering. Although sometime it is mandatory, which I will come in the late, that sometime we can approach in a total way, which is called a syndromic approach. But mostly, if especially in the private clinics, when the patient is coming, you don't have that type of load, which is with the government hospitals, we should always give the test. Meantime, patient can have something to be relieved. And this wet preparation is a wonderful thing. Although many times it is not possible to do in our OPDs, at that time, taking a pap smear or deciding on the culture, think what you're thinking for the patient, go for the culture in that way, aerobic, anaerobic. Chlamydia kits are different, and take that cultures, although it then become very, very expensive. And why we are very, very worried about Trichomonas vaginalis infection, because it has come in the category of the sexually transmitted disease. It is not, it is, does not come in the non-STD. Number two, if this persists, this infection, it can even cause problem in the pregnant woman and can lead to the premature rupture of membrane, preterm deliveries, delivery of a low birth weight. So many a time, this persistent discharge also can be a reason future problem. So my next question to Dr. Shashilata Kabra. What is non-sexually transmitted infection which can cause discharge? If I, as I told that Trichomonas is a sexually transmitted disease, do we have something like non-sexually transmitted infection, Dr. Shashilata Kabra? Hello?
Hello. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there are many non-sexually transmitted infections, like very common infections in females. One is bacterial vaginosis and also candida infections. They are very common. They present with discharge, irritation, and malodorous discharge, but they are not otherwise sexually transmitted. And besides this, some non-infective components also cause discharge, like in physiological condition, then ectopia of the cervix, and if a foreign body is retained, like very commonly tampon is retained, and different types of vulval dermatitis and may also lead to discharges.
Thank you, Shashi. The one word about this cervical ectopy, which I want to convey to our end users, that is, this is one of the most common problem of the discharge when we are not able to find any reason why this woman is all the time she is having a discharge. And when we examine, what we found is a cervical ectopy or cervical erosion on the cervix. And only by the treatment of that cervical ectopy or erosion, patient get benefited. So my next question is to Niharika. What sexually transmitted infections present with the vaginal discharge in your practice?
Good afternoon, everyone. So we are talking about sexually transmitted infections. So first, we have to know that sexually transmitted infections can happen from sexual intercourse, and it can also happen in homosexuals. So the commonest cause sexually transmitted infections which we know of are mainly chlamydia, gonorrhea, and trichomoniasis. These are very common and are usually present with vaginal discharge, and they have a typical feature of vaginal discharge with them. Like trichomoniasis is mostly commonly has a greenish yellow tinge of discharge. So once they come with the vaginal discharge and you know they are sexually active, then a common per speculum examination can actually differentiate and give us a clue of what kind of discharge and what kind of causative organism it can be.
Thank you, Niharika. So, Dr. Rasi, can you tell us what about the concurrent sexually transmitted infection? When a patient, is it possible that we are thinking of the Trichomonas and patient may have some other infection also? So if a patient is coming to you, what other thing you will think in your mind?
Yes, definitely. We should actually rule out for all other causes of discharge. In fact, when we are looking at Trichomonas vaginalis infection, we should also keep in mind that the other common causes of vaginal discharge, the sexually transmitted infections, like chlamydial and gonococcal infections. So we should specifically look for such infections. And if it is possible, if we are in an endemic zone, then we need to do those lab tests, swabs, cervical swabs, high cervical, endocervical swabs, and then start treatment, because very commonly these two infections coexist. We call it as dual infections, chlamydial and gonococcal. They both exist together concurrently. And many of the women, when they get this infection, they are actually asymptomatic. So we should specifically be of that mindset when we are examining or asking her history. We should be of that mindset whether we want to look out for concurrent STDs.
So from all this discussion, what we came to the conclusion, the three very, very important things. First thing, the partner should be always notified and the treatment always given to the partner also. And we always think, not focus that patient is having only one infection. She can be harboring one or two infection, and a full treatment should be offered, and always follow up that patient is very, very necessary to treat this patient completely, because these, especially sexually transmitted infection, can lead to the sequelae and causes more of the systemic problem to the woman also. So next question is my to Dr. Mala Srivastava. What newer test we have with us other than this wet prep, which we are using since we are students, there are certain new tests that have come up now. Can you please throw a light on it?
Yeah, besides regular tests that we are doing, like pH estimation, pH test, and wet test, I have other tests also, nuclear test, nuclear acid amplification tests, such as polymerase chain reaction and ligase chain reaction. These are molecular biological techniques that amplify DNA and other genetic material. These tests can detect tiny amounts of cells or viruses and are very highly sensitive and specific. So these tests are coming up and they can really help us in diagnosing the condition of the patient.
And yes.
Besides special cultures for different organisms, which are very costly and very difficult to do.
Thank you. Although these tests are a little expensive, but when we don't have any clue and patient is having problem continuously, we want to continue the medication. Sometimes we have to subject to these tests also. But usually, in the most of us in our practice don't use these tests regularly because they are very, very expensive and not available at every place.
Most commonly used tests are pH test, which can give us some clue. And maybe wet mount, AOH, and WIF test. These are commonly used and it can be easily used in the clinic. Then comes your cultures. You can take the encephalitis culture if you're suspecting gonorrhea. And then we can also, under microscope, we can see the blue cells. And then comes the culture and the NAT test, etc.
Thank you, Mala. We have with us Dr. Parag Beniwale, Secretary.
And Dr. Parag is gone for an emergency.
He had an emergency. So this question then will go to Dr. Chandan. Dr. Chandan is the international authority on adolescent, and she is a speaker in even the international conferences. So Dr. Chandan, instead of Parag, now you give the answer of this question, that being the adolescent patient, do you think she should be given some extra advice? What we give in general our married woman?
Yes, definitely we have to give a different sort of an approach towards adolescent, because first of all, adolescent will never give you the full history unless you are very, particular about her privacy and give her being non-judgmental and give her patient hearing. Then only she will give you the right history. She might be pregnant also, you have to, sexual history also, you have to get it very nicely. Otherwise, she will not give you the history. You will not be able to find out any of her diagnosis. That's very important.
One thing I just want to say.
Yeah.
Yes.
That we should ask, because she is an adolescent, 17-year-old, and had a sexual intercourse, so we should ask her to come back when she misses her period.
Pregnancy has to be removed.
Yeah.
The important thing is there is a HEDIS approach to approach an adolescent. That means you have to start from home. You have to see her, what are her peers, who are the people whom she is in contact with, her partner, and what sort of her academics. You have to go laterally to approach an adolescent. You cannot have a direct questioning with them. Make a friends with them, then you will come with all the, whatever you want to, the history from them.
And it is important to be empathetic to the patient, and we have to treat her in a very non-judgmental way and we should give her advice regarding future contraception also, because the treatment will be incomplete without this counseling.
Madam, and actually 17-year-old becomes a little challenging here because of the medico-legal aspect definitely. Of POXO also in this case.
But somehow the counseling can be done.
Counseling can be done. Yeah.
We cannot offer, but we can do the counseling. This message I want to give to the whole society and our fellow gynecologists, that we should not leave any window of opportunity to share the knowledge with the our patients or adolescents, because these adolescents many a time they are not aware for which they are headed for towards what they are heading. So it is our responsibility to teach them about contraception, although it is very difficult to teach them. I am totally agree with you, because with the PASCO Act it does not recognize that we should tell them that they can have sex. But already a girl which we are sitting with us, she has a history of the sex. It is our responsibility to give a contraception advice. Dr. Niharika, yes. Yeah, please.
May I say something?
Yes.
Ma'am, here I would suggest we should take this also as an opportunity to counsel her regarding vaccination for HPV and rubella.
Yes.
So apart from all the workup of vaginal discharge, HPV vaccination may in the longer run prevent her against lot of trouble. And of course, we are counseling about.
For the non-medicos here, we can tell them that there is a vaccine available for against cervical cancer and the venereal warts, for which they can come, and it can be given to the children from 9 years of age by their pediatrician. Up to 14 years age, only 2 doses are needed, and after that 3 doses are needed. For this, they can contact their gynecologist or their pediatrician.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, rubella vaccination is being brought under universal immunization schedule, but hasn't been accepted yet. But HPV vaccine, I think as role of gynecologists, we have a crucial role in promoting it to all our patients at whatever opportunity we get.
Yeah. So the thing is that a girl is coming with a vaginal discharge to us, or any woman who are coming with a small problem which is called a vaginal discharge, we should not overlook and take it as an opportunity to teach laterally whatever is connected to the vaginal discharge. Dr. Niharika, last comment from you as a young talent promotion company.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I would I'll add a little bit here about POSCO Act also, because she's 17-year-old and she does fall into the POSCO Act. So as a clinician, we also have to take into all the medical legal considerations of her having unprotected intercourse under the age of 18. So a legal opinion maybe should be kept in mind, I feel.
Okay. Thank you. So now, Chandan, please share.
Ma'am, I think your slides can go and Okay. Yeah. So second case, Mrs. X, 29 years of age, presented with 4 weeks of persistent vaginal discharge. The discharge was greenish, foul smelling, of moderate in volume, and accompanied with mild lower abdominal pain. She has 2 children, 8 and 6 year old, separated but sexually active. She is jobless, has multiple partners, and having sex without condoms, as she has fitted with copper tea. She did not experience fever, dysuria, or loin pain. She believed her vaginal discharge was caused by a sexually transmitted infection due to one casual unprotected sexual encounter. So Dr. Anita, I'll ask you, how will you approach this case?
So first of all, thank you from my side to all the organizers. It's a pleasure to be in the panel. Regarding this patient, she's 29-year-old young adult female, and she has had unprotected intercourse, and she has got multiple partners. So history taking is very, very important in this patient, and we have to do a thorough examination. I want to highlight this point very, very carefully to all my listening colleagues, that we should not give a treatment without examination in such kind of patient who has had history of unprotected sex with multiple partners, and the symptoms are persisting for more than 4 weeks now. So we have to do a thorough examination, and when we did the examination of this patient, she had a greenish dirty mass like structure in the vagina, which could be removed with sponge holder. Most probably it was a forgotten tampon. So after removal of the tampon, when we saw the cervix appeared normal, we could see the copper-T thread, because she was giving history of copper-T insertion. So copper-T was very much there. The uterus was normal, and there was slight tenderness on moving the uterus. There was mild cervical tenderness also. So the patient was further investigated, and you know, we have to, after thorough examination, we'll need to do some investigations for her to rule out other infections. Like we can do pap smear, and we can send the vaginal swab for gram staining and culture sensitivity. Then this, you know, what diagnosis was made was intravaginal forgotten foreign body secondary bacterial infection. So we see that many young women, even children or peri or postmenopausal women, may present to gynae OPD with atypical symptoms of vaginal discharge, which may have been caused by some forgotten sponge or some menstrual aid, or in children there may be foreign bodies like toys. Like adolescent females, they can have you know, sexual fantasy objects, and menopausal or perimenopausal, you may find forgotten pessaries or other aids. So regarding this patient, we gave her prophylactic antibiotics, because she was presenting with discharge. So she was given, you know, combination of ofloxacin and timidazole twice a day, and she was asked to come after 3 days for follow-up visit. Surprisingly, we saw that all the reports were normal, and patient was feeling quite well. So no further treatment was required. Antibiotic course was completed. And besides, because she was having copper-T, but we counseled her for safe sex practice. Like, we counseled her that copper-T may be a good contraceptive, but she has to take precautions for sexually transmitted infection. And she was, you know, counseled regarding all the nitty-gritties and all the precautions she should take. She should avoid multiple partners. Obviously, it's very difficult to counsel patients in this situation, but we can do whatever in our purview is. And patient was quite, you know, understanding, and she understood the problem she had faced. Patient should, in such cases, patient should be called for follow-up visit also.
Now, Dr. Mala, why is it important to properly evaluate this case, not to write medicine with syndromic approach, like we sometimes use the syndromic approach in certain cases?
Vaginal discharge, we have to actually take a proper history and then do a proper speculum examination and then come to a professional diagnosis. If we had not done a examination in this particular patient, then we would have missed the tampon or not. Some patients, they, like Dr. Anita told, like young girls, small girls, they put some foreign body bees and buttons in the vagina also, just by curiosity. And even young girls, adolescents, and like most patients, they also forget that they are using pessaries, or they are using copper tea for long 20, 30 years. All these patients get with start. If this patient had not first been, then we would have missed that retained tampon. And one of the commonest causes of persistent foul smelling discharge can be retained tampon. And it can be overlooked as a discharge, but the patient can be malodorous and persistent vaginal discharge, not nicely treated or not getting treated easily. So every time you get a patient who's having IUD, intermittent contraceptive device, she gives a history of contraceptive device, or she can give history of some pessary or some property, some intervention has been done, some or some been done. And in that case, perspective action can be very helpful in diagnosing disorder. Why diagnosing disorder is important? Because otherwise it can lead to a condition known as toxic
shock.
And this toxic shock.
We are sorry that Dr. Mala's audio is not that clear. I can understand. But if we keep it small, I mean, extra air to it, then you will be able to hear it. Yes, ma'am. Yes, Dr. Mala, please.
These foreign bodies, they can be very important because if we miss them, they can be toxic shock syndrome.
Yes.
Toxic shock syndrome presents an acute syndrome complex associated with the release of endotoxin from the staph aureus infection.
Yeah.
High fever, generalized enteroderma, vomiting, diarrhea, hypotensive shock, and maybe sometimes acute renal failure as well. This malodorous retinal discharge is a common presentation sometimes with diarrhea. Especially, we have to talk about, we have to take the history of IUD insertion, states of attack wounds, arsenic procedure in the past. Sometimes you have a normal delivery patient coming after seeing house swelling discharge. And you, on examination, you found that there is a forgotten swab in the vagina.
Yes, yes.
Sometimes you have a busy gynae who don't want to do a clinical examination, and then it's a fallacy to give treatment to these women without doing a perspective and PD examination. Only when we do PD examination, perspective, and only we can diagnose these cases and then treat. Otherwise, we miss cases and these patients go from pillar to pillar, not getting treated, not getting any benefit of any treatments. So these
Thank you.
Have to be taken very carefully and very seriously.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mala. And for the non-medicos who are you know, listening to it, Dr. Mala's video was not that clear. I'm very sorry for that. What she says that the sometimes you are using tampons, then you forget to take them out. It can get infected and you will can lead into a problem called as toxic shock syndrome, which is a very, very dangerous situation. So what is the syndromic management of vaginal discharge? Dr. Ragini, can you please unmute yourself, ma'am?
Regarding toxic shock,
can I this syndromic management also.
Yes, Dr. Anita, please take this.
Yeah, regarding toxic shock syndrome, I want to tell my audience a story that in 1978, the company will name I will not tell, but they came up with the super absorbent vaginal tampons. They were made of polymethyl cellulose and compressed polyester fiber particles. So they used to absorb 20 times their weight. So it was said that one tampon was enough for whole menses period of 4 to 5 days. So what they used to put the young girls used to use those tampon and just forget about it. And you know, that got infected, and they say because it absorbed everything. So it was super absorbent. So when they used to introduce, they used to call mild erosions or mild injury in vaginal epithelium. So whatever toxin was being produced due to retained tampon used to get absorbed without those interruptions in vaginal epithelium. So many young girls fell sick. So the epidemiologist started investigating why there is so much of morbidity. There were two mortalities also because of this toxic shock syndrome. So they investigated it, and in 1980, these companies that withdrew the super absorbent tampons. Now they are using other ones which are not super absorbent. So that was the story I was telling you to my non-medical friends. So whatever material you are buying, please be very, very careful that it should not be super absorbent.
Yes. One more message,
ma'am, I would like to ask.
Yeah.
Yes, sorry.
So it's not to scare anyone for using tampons, but if you are using, for normal people who are using tampons here, you should understand that the tampons have to be kept at a maximum of 6 or 8 hours. You have to change your tampons after 8 hours, because this infection, which is called toxic shock syndrome, can come as early as 12 hours. So if your tampon is inside for more than 12 hours, the infection will begin. And the symptoms come only after 3 to 5 days. So if you're using tampons, just make sure you remove them after 6 hours.
And it is true for those days also when your flow is less. So if your flow is less, you tend to keep your tampons for a longer time. So my dear friends, please be aware and change your tampon after 6 hours, as very well highlighted by Nihari.
Dr. Anita, not only tampons, I have seen patients, you know, wearing even pads for, you know, even they are not stained, they will keep them for even 24 hours like that. Madam, isme to kuch aaya nahi, isliye humne 24 ghante bhi pads lag diya. Not only tampons, but they have to be told that even pads which are kept for more than 6 to 8 hours, they have to be removed.
This is a good message which we are conveying to our dear friends. Please be very careful about the menstrual hygiene.
Yes, Dr. Anita, about the syndromic management of vaginal discharge.
Regarding syndromic management, like now COVID timings are going on, you know, patient cannot come for the treatment. We are doing phone triage. We are asking our patients on phone regarding their symptoms. So if you are not able to actually call the person into our clinic for proper examination, we can advise them either on telephone, or if they come and there is no, you know, facility for them being examined by doctors, like they are being taken care of by field staff, then this approach is a, you know, good alternative. Syndromic management, if you allow, I can show you the pack. This actually syndromic management, you know, treats the patient according to the symptom of the patient without any examination. So definite, you know, packs are available, combinations are available, and these combinations are given according to the symptoms of patient. If you allow me, I can show them the package. Sinusitis or urethral discharge. WHO has given, DIPO and WHO have given these kind of kits which have, you know, combination of azithromycin 1 gram and cefixime is there, 400 milligrams. This is of single use. So can you see this? This is a gray.
Yes,
this
yes.
This is a gray kit. This is NACO.
Toys, Deepika.
This is a green kit. This is given for vaginal discharge. Like, patient cannot come with her complaints to the clinic. The you know, the field workers like ANMs and our dear Ashas, they can give these kits meanwhile. This kit is for vaginal discharge. It has, you know, technical.
Dr. Anita, are they free of cost?
They are free of cost. All government hospitals are having clinics, special clinics. They are called Suraksha clinics. They are specifically for these kind of problems only. Patients are screened for sexually transmitted infections, pelvic inflammatory disease, HIV, etc. Because there is a counselor specifically who sits there and does this job. She will screen the patient also. She will invite the partner also, counsel the partner, and treat the partner if required, and follow up is done properly. So these kinds of things become very, you know, they become very helpful in syndromic treatment of the patient.
I just want to say one thing, Dr. Chandan, regarding
Yes, ma'am. Yes, Dr. Shashi.
As Dr. Ragini has said, that the lots of OPD patients come with vaginal discharge, and that's a very common problem in gynae OPD. And in my hospital, the same problem is there. So I have made a stamp which writes azithromycin tablet 1 gram stat, cefixime tablet 400 milligrams stat, fluconazole 150 milligrams stat, and timidazole 1 BD for 3 days. And this I give, these patients do not come to us regularly. Sometimes they can't come for follow-up. So this, this time I put on those prescriptions and I advise them to be taken by husband also, both the partners. So that we get a very good response with that. I have been practicing this for last 15 to 20 years.
Thanks a lot.
This message should not go that patient does not need an examination.
Yeah. Yes.
And she does not need a follow-up.
We examine them, message to us.
Message to the our other colleagues who are listening. Hello?
This is only in special situation.
Ma'am, there is one more very important point in this patient that she was having a copper tea and still she had, she thought that she will never get any right. infection. So she has to take a, because she had multiple partners. Yeah. So she has to take care of the sexually transmitted. Yeah. Yes. That's very important for the public to know.
Yeah.
She should not take it seriously.
She has to use some conventional yeah. Like condom.
Yes.
Just to close.
Yes, Dr. Over to Dr. Agni, ma'am.
Just to close before the next question, next case discussion, from all discussion, 4 points has come. Number one, the menstrual hygiene, which everybody should follow. Change your tampon or your pad regularly. Don't think if it is not stained, you should continue because it can lead to infection otherwise. The second thing is the barrier method, especially if you have multiple partners.
Yes.
Or you are having some infections, it is always better to use a condom, which is a barrier method, which prevents the transfer of the STD. Copper tea is a very, very good thing to prevent the pregnancy, but it is not preventing the sexual transmitted disease. And the third thing which comes out is syndromic approach, but syndromic approach is good for one time, but if you are experiencing discharge continuously or recurrently, you need more than that. And patients should not be treated without examining, because without examination, sometime you can land up with these type of thing also. One can, if this woman is unleft, only given a pack by Asha, not coming to the doctor, not examining, she can die also. So I'm coming to my next case. This can just I, like giving
can
the,
I add
this,
something? Can I
yes,
add?
Yes, of course, you come, you are silent so much, Dr. Ashok Kumar. Please,
no,
you
come. On syndromic approach, I just want to add that actually the concept of syndromic approach by the government of India, that where the resources are not available, where gynecologists are not available, in that situation, even medicine or any health worker, by the symptomology, can give these ready-made packs which are available by the government of India to these patients and to which can include the treatment for the partner also. A patient has approached a hospital facility or health facility where a expert doctor is available or gynecologist is available, it is always better to take proper history, examine the patient and then prescribe the specific treatment. Syndromic approach is not to be followed by the expert. That is what I have to add.
Thank you, Dr. Ashok. Now coming to the next question, 42 years old. Now our patient from adolescent to reproductive age is entering now to the perimenopause age. This 42-year-old Mrs. Y, who is an old patient, she phoned the secretary and asked for the prescription for vaginal itching and discharge. She has taken some OTC drug for yeast infection, because most of our patient, when they come, they say, madam, we are having a yeast infection. So yeast infection is like surf to detergent. So yeast infection, but no avail, and suffering for 12 days. So Dr. Shashi Lata, you can tell me, is it ever appropriate to treat without an examination? She's your old patient. You know her very well. You just tell your secretary, give her this tablet. Don't ask her to come. She cannot come. Her husband is traveling. She's alone. So yes, how will you will approach this patient?
Madam, I never advise telemedicine, especially for discharges. I must see the discharge and then I should advise. I will call this patient to my clinic. And I will examine her properly, and then that examination includes a clear picture or clear examination of external genitalia and internal genitalia. And after seeing this, I will advise her. And one more important point, this particular patient, she has already taken medicine. and still she is not cured. So it is more advisable to see her.
So it is very, very important to examine the patient.
So for examination purpose, we have to take a proper history. What is the duration of the symptoms? And if there is any recent changes in the symptoms, or whether she has been experiencing any associated dyspareunia or dysuria, because they are sometimes associated symptoms. And we should take a detailed history of about duration of symptoms, the relation of the symptoms with menstrual cycle, whether they occur prior or during, and whether they had attempted any treatment earlier, and also a detailed history about their sexual practices. So in that, these regarding the physical examination, I will do a careful inspection of the vulva, because we may get vulvovaginal candidiasis, redness on the vulva, and sometimes different type of vulva dysplasia can be seen, including leukoplakia. And I will also do internal examinations by the speculum. And at the time of taking internal examination, we can check the pH. Usually the pH should be taken from the middle part of the sample for pH to be taken from the middle part of the vagina, so that the false readings because of semen, because of blood, because of mucus should not come into picture. And then we can also do a slight preparation with KOH and with normal saline. And we can also look for the VIP test, a different type of amine type of odor can be seen. And the swab, and it is to be tested. And for if we make a slide with normal saline and KOH, then the slide should be quickly tested. And this way we can diagnose different parts of.
Okay, thank you, Sashi. Over to Rasi. Can you tell me what are the other disadvantages of the using non-prescription antifungal agents?
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Ma'am, actually, unless and until we have seen the patient, to just prescribe it on telephonic consultation, or because the patient is telling you that I have yeast, it can create a lot of problems physically to the patient also, and maybe later on medico-legally for us also. So as a principle, doctors and patients equally, those who are listening to this webinar, they should understand that there are certain entities for which you must visit the doctor and get an examination done. So howsoever trivial your complaint might appear, the problems of having these antifungal agents self-prescribed could range from anything like redness, itching, irritation, local irritation, to increase in the amount of infection such that patient may end up in a pelvic inflammatory disease, or florid acute cystitis, or a urethritis, or a urinary tract infection like that. So it is very essential that we see the patient first and then prescribe.
Thank you, Rasi. Niharika?
Can I add? Yes,
yes, yes, please.
Hello?
Yes, Dr. Ashok.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you can add.
I just wanted to add that, especially in these perimenopausal women, it is also important to examine the patient, because there might be early features of malignancy. That is what we have to rule out in all cases.
Yes.
Where abnormal vaginal discharge.
Thank you. So these points are very important. Why the simple vaginal discharge? One hand, it is a physiological, and other hand, it can be an indication of a early, very early indication of any underlying diseases, maybe a start of the diabetes to the malignancy. So Niharika, can you tell us what else should be considered in the differential diagnosis of this patient?
Yes, ma'am. So first of all, for all the viewers who are here, I would just like to say that what is vaginitis? So when you think about vaginitis, it is an inflammation of the vagina, which causes discharge, itching and pain. So whenever you have a discharge, there can be multiple causes, and these multiple causes can be ruled out according to your proper history evaluation, which a doctor does, and a per speculum. And sometimes we need laboratory investigations. So for this patient, when she came, we know that she's come with discharge, and the differential diagnosis which we can here think of is most commonly can be bacterial vaginosis, which I feel, or it can also be candidiasis.
Okay. So, coming to Dr. Ashok, on examination, the vaginal pH is high in this patient and microscopic findings are equivocal. How should this patient to be managed? How you can say this patient is suffering from this thing? After doing the pH, which is a very, very common thing which we do in the OPDs, just to see that pH is high or low than the normal pH of the vagina, which is usually acidic.
Actually, when the we are not able to find out what is there, this picture or this scenario can happen when the patient has been treated by a person already with multiple therapies, or it might be a bacterial infection. So examination will be helpful in that. We can differentiate whether this infection is limited to local area, vaginitis or cervicitis, or it has gone to the disease involving the reproductive organs. So that is important to differentiate when we examine these patients. And accordingly, because if the patient has pelvic systemic treatment also. And in these situations where we are not sure of the what time, if possible, if facilities are available, one can go for extensive workup in terms of culture or other, as Dr. Mala has different types of tests which are available. One can go and accordingly one can proceed for these patients. But don't forget to keep in mind the unusual or unusual causes like malignancy or foreign body, or it may be something like that, one has to keep in mind.
So Anita, finally this patient is turned out to be the candidiasis, or what we normally in the general term we say the yeast infection. How will you treat this patient, Anita?
So, you know, the patient came with a lot of irritation and discharge. Now, depending on history, and now we have examined her, when we do this the examination of such patient, we will find that there is a curdy white discharge in the vagina, which is very, very sticky and adherent to the vaginal mucosa, means inner lining of the vagina. So it will be difficult to, you know, take it out from the inner lining of vagina. So it is a sticky, adherent, white, curdy white discharge. So it leads us to somehow to diagnosis of that this patient is suffering from yeast infection. We can confirm the diagnosis by doing certain tests. Like Dr. Shashi has already told, we can do a KOH wet mount. We can, take vaginal secretion, mix it with 10% KOH and take one drop of it and see it under the microscope. We'll be seeing the branch and budding hyphae of the growing yeast. You know, the discharge gets sticky because of this, because these budding hyphae, they invade inside the epithelium. So it becomes sticky and adherent to the inner lining of vagina. Or if you find that the woman is very symptomatic and you are not finding anything on clinical examination, then we will like to do a culture of this patient. Sometimes, you know, even if you are not able to have anything on per speculum examination, we can get a positive culture with atypical candidia or other yeast. So, you know, now the treatment will depend on the species we'll find on the smear or culture examination. So regarding the next question which has been posed to me is how to treat the patient. So there are two types of patients: the uncomplicated patient who do not have any underlying disease or predisposing factor like diabetes, pregnancy, history of oral pill use, or other immunosuppressant agents being used. Then we can, in this case, we can simply treat her with local or what we call as topical clotrimazole cream, or we can give her oral fluconazole. But if the patient is having underlying disease, she's coming with the, you know, recurrent candidal infection. We call it recurrent if she has got more than 4 episodes in a year. Then we'll need to give her chronic suppressive therapy. You have to give her fluconazole initially, 150 milligram every third day, maybe for a week. Or then she has to be put on weekly dosage for at least 3 to 6 months. And recall method should be there, that patient should come definitely for follow-up. And sometimes we can use, you know, vaginal ointments also, which are available. There are 2% creams are available. You have to use those 2% clotrimazole vaginal cream. 5 gram of it has to be inserted daily once for 3 days. So there are many methods by which you can treat the patient.
Yes, candidiasis is a very, very common thing in population. So we are stressing it again and again. Now, Niharika, can you summarize whatever we have discussed in bullet points to understand with everyone in a very, very simple language?
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, first of all, we were talking about candidiasis. We know it's a yeast infection, and it is one of the commonest infections which we see. Almost 47% of women who present with vaginal discharge in a gynec OPD will have candidiasis. And we have seen it as an opportunistic infection. So whenever the immunity of the body goes down, candidiasis can happen. And most of the common risk factors in this are like diabetes, pregnancy, prolonged use of even antibiotics can cause recurrent candidal infections. And it has 3 strains, common strains, which are like Candida albicans, Glabrata, and Tropicalis. But we mostly have seen that Candida albicans is the commonest one which we do. And it is very easy to diagnose. If you do a good per-speculum examination, a curdy white discharge will tell you that it is candidiasis. But you can also do a microscopic examination, as ma'am already told us, with KOH to diagnose, and can easily be treated by a vaginal pessary or a single shot of antibiotic.
We've lost your audio, Niharika.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
You're finished, Niharika?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, you want me to add anything else?
Okay. So I just want to add one thing.
Yes, ma'am.
Which I have seen in many of my patients. This recurrent candidal infection, many a time it comes from the husband. So the history of the diabetes in husband is very, very important, because any person who is diabetic is going to have a candidal infection. Candida is a part of normal part of your body. And every diabetic patient at some time, they have a mildly candidal infection in your body. So history of husband is very important. And especially if the husband is diabetic, it is better to use condom always.
So I will remind my viewers that please understand that candidiasis is not a sexually transmitted infection. Yes. It is a, you know, normal resident of vaginal flora, but in special situations, like if you are on immunocompromised, you have had fever, or just recovered from any, you know, sickness, or you are using oral contraceptives or antibiotics for a very long time, you may get this, you know, overwhelming infection of your own normal vaginal flora, which is the yeast. So partner treatment is definitely important, and we should ask the couple to abstain from sex till the treatment is over.
Thank you, Dr. Anita.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for all this. Dr. Niharika, I just want to ask you one thing. Dr. Niharika, are you listening? I have seen lots of patients of candidiasis using a lot of V-wash these days. So what do you suggest?
Excessive use of vaginal wash also can cause recurrent infections, because it disturbs your normal flora. So we actually do not advise them to use them regularly, because the media is showing it on now advertisement.
Yes.
So people are actually using them without a prescription.
Yes.
So that's what is important, that please do not use all these products without prescription.
Yes. Because they will be, imbalancing the normal pH of the vagina and creating more problems for them.
Dr. Chandan, I just want to add.
Yes, ma'am, please.
According to CDC guidelines, none of these type of douching and weevil should be.
Yes. Yes.
Rather they increase the chances of getting different
type of infections. Yes.
Also, Dr. Kachru, women also are now going for waxing of the hairs of that also increases your risk of vaginal infections.
See, these are very important points for the non-medical people who are watching this discussion. So they should get proper knowledge about it. Yes. That's why I wanted to discuss this. So next, Dr. Mala, can you please tell us something about bacterial vaginosis?
We are talking all the time bacterial vaginosis.
Bacterial vaginosis. Make it easy for us.
Bacterial vaginosis is defined as a condition that reflects abnormal vaginal flora. Normal vaginal flora has lots of lactobacillus, and this lactobacillus produces lactic acid, which maintains a low vaginal pH, less than 4.5. And this acidic bacteria, this acidic pH, it helps in preventing infections, especially infections like HIV, etc. So if there is an infection, there is a disturbance due to some factor, if this normal flora is disturbed, then in that case, patients will get infections from anaerobic species like Gardnerella vaginalis, Uroplasma uriliticum, Mobiluncus, Mycoplasma, and P. vulgare. Then this causes a condition called bacterial vaginosis. Patients will have symptoms like they can be slight discharge, non-irritating, maladherous vaginal discharge. And when we have to diagnose them, we can diagnose specifically by checking the pH of the vagina. That already Dr. Sashi said that you have to take the pH from the middle part of the lateral wall of the vagina. And this pH, if it is more than 4.5, it can give a clue that this patient may be having bacterial vaginosis. Then other tests can be whiff test, presence of blue cells, and Gram stain can also help in diagnosis of the bacterial vaginosis. Why bacterial vaginosis is important? Because in the patients who are pregnant, it can lead to preterm labor, preterm rupture of membranes, and also cause other problems to the neonates as well as the mother. But in case the patient is not pregnant, then also it can cause pelvic inflammatory diseases, and it may sometimes also cause infertility to these patients. So diagnosing of bacterial vaginosis is very important, and we should know if the patient is coming to us, we should not try to miss the diagnosis of bacterial vaginosis. Treatment, of course, is not difficult. You can give either metronidazole 500 milligrams 2 times a day for 7 days, or local gel can also be given vaginally, metronidazole gel, bedtime for 5 days. Otherwise, clindamycin can be given vaginally at night for 7 days. So treatment is not difficult. Idea is to diagnose the condition, treat the patient whether she's pregnant or non-pregnant, and so that she does not have the
next slide
problems.
So here we should know there's something called abnormal vaginal flora. So there's something called normal vaginal flora also. So for our non-medical friends, I want to say that vagina is full of bacteria. That is a normal thing. It contains a normal bacteria, that is lactobacillus. And when this lactobacillus maintains the pH of the vagina, and it is very, very important. These all use of unnecessary douching, use of the V-wash and too much of the antibiotics. These things many a time disturb the vaginal flora, and when the lactobacillus is not there, decreased, especially in the perimenopausal age, because of the lack of the estrogen, it is decreasing. It can lead to the growth of the abnormal vaginal flora and leading to the bacterial vaginosis, as Dr. Mala has told you that it has leads to lots of obstetric and gynecological problem. That's why it is very, very important to treat. And one point which I want to say, that your immunity really, really play a big role. And sometime nutrition deficiency like vitamin D, your hemoglobin is low. This thing also predisposes the bacterial vaginosis in you.
About the gonorrhea, Dr. Rajsi, can you please tell us something about gonorrhea?
Yes, definitely. See, gonorrhea is basically a bacterial infection. This is a type of a bacterium which is a non-motile, two paired parts, diplococci as we call it. and that is specifically transmitted through unprotected sexual intercourse. So ladies who are people who are having multiple sexual partners, who are promiscuous, who do have unprotected sexual intercourse without using condoms properly, these are the people who are very, very susceptible and most at risk to get gonococcal infection. And gonococcal infection, gonorrhea, is one of the most important sexually transmitted disease which causes a bad vaginal discharge. Where does this thing affect mostly? So it affects all the warm body parts, warm and moist body parts, like the urethra, the area from which we pass urine, vagina, of course, definitely, because that is where most of the time sexual intercourse happens. Then other places where it can affect is the oral mucosa and also through the eyes. And when it spreads through our bloodstream, then that condition is called as disseminated gonococcal infection. In disseminated infection, it can affect your heart, your artha, your joints, and create more problems as compared to the localized disease. How do we prevent gonococcal infection? Is basically by abstinence or by being faithful to your partner, having monogamous relationship, not having multiple partners, and using condoms at every possible time for doing sexual intercourse. The symptoms with which gonococcal infections present, many times there are no symptoms. We call such patients as asymptomatic. And gonococci affect the men as well as women. In men, it causes burning in the urination, urethritis type of a picture. Sometimes some purulent discharge may come out through the penis. In women, again, it causes a bad vaginal discharge. It causes dysuria, which is pain during urination. It causes dyspareunia, which is pain during sexual intercourse. Then it can cause irregular intermenstrual uterine bleeding. Sometimes it causes abnormal bleeding, like very heavy bleeding or bleeding after intercourse, something like that. So abnormalities in the menstrual pattern and vaginal discharge is what constitutes the important symptoms of gonococcal infection. Complications from this infection, if left untreated, it can rise up through your uterus to your tubes. It could spread inside your in your abdominal cavity. It can cause you a condition called as pelvic inflammatory disease, that is PID. The fallopian tubes of your uterus may get blocked and it may lead to infertility. And sometimes because of damage to the fallopian tubes, you can get something called as an ectopic pregnancy, in which the pregnancy happens in the tube rather than happening in the uterus. So that condition could be potentially quite catastrophic. So these are the complications of gonococcal infection. Treatment is majorly, before that I'll tell you about the investigations, how to diagnose it. See, as I said, many infections are asymptomatic. So many times they get missed. Only when patient presents with recurrent urinary infection or a discharge, you can do a pelvic examination. Your doctor will do an internal examination and take some liquid from your cervix, the endocervical canal, on a swab and send it for diagnosis. That way we can find out whether there is active gonococcal infection. The treatment consists of antibiotics. Which antibiotics commonly used are ceftriaxone, which is a group of fourth generation cephalosporin, or fluoroquinolones constituting like ciprofloxacin or levofloxacin or ofloxacin. Even for first and second generation cephalosporins may also be used, like cefixime, 400 milligram per oral in single dose. Mind you, but this infection, as I already had mentioned, is generally concurrent with another infection called as chlamydia.
So, chlamydia will be taken by Dr. Mala.
Yeah, I'm just mentioning it. Yeah. I'm not telling about it.
Yes.
I'm just telling that when you're treating for gonococcal infection,
concurrent infection.
Yeah, concurrent infection. You have to keep it in mind and treat for both. So, azithromycin, which is good for chlamydia, can also be added while treating for a suspected gonococcal infection.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rasi. And thanks. Dr. Mala, now your turn to tell us something about chlamydia.
Before Mala speaks, I just want to say that as a principle, if the patient has come with one sexually transmitted infection, she should be screened for other causes.
It's with Niharika, not Dr. Mala. Dr. Mala is already spoken.
Okay, so there's a confusion.
Yeah, Clamidia, I just want to say one thing. Be little more towards the our other listeners also. Make it little more simpler.
Yes, yes. Dr. Niharika. Niharika, are you there? Niharika? I think she's she's muted or?
So, although we have discussed everything, bacterial vaginosis and detail with her, Rasi has already said that chlamydia is a concurrent disease with the gonorrhea. We should always think when we see the patient of chlamydia. And the main thing is that chlamydia, only 30% of the women have a chlamydial symptoms. Usually the symptom what they have, burning sensation, painful sexual intercourse, rectal pains, symptoms of PIG and vaginal discharge. Mostly it is asymptomatic and the only complaint which comes is a vaginal discharge. And silently chlamydia goes inside the tube and causes a PID-like pelvic inflammatory disease, mild pain in abdomen. Even it is today, it is coming up like a one of the symptom of infertility also. Yes. What Niharika is there? She came. Yes, Niharika,
so my light went off, the network went.
Take over.
So you can take over.
I just tell them the symptom of the chlamydia.
We have only come to the symptoms of chlamydia. Later, now you can go to the next one.
Okay, so we are talking about chlamydia, and we know that it is a disease caused by chlamydia trachomatis, and we know the symptoms like burning, micturition and vaginal discharge, itching, and also some people do get rectal discharge, but we also know that even 30% of women will be asymptomatic, but they can also have chlamydia. Chlamydia is a problematic organism because it is now seen that most infertile people have chlamydia, and untreated chlamydia can lead to infertility because it damages the tubes. And the important part to understand is that it is commonly seen in people who have multiple sexual partners or people who are highly diabetic also, and it's very contagious. So it can go from it travels highly contagious between the couple. So, and it can easily be treated once diagnosed. A single shot of azithromycin is actually sufficient for chlamydia. And once if you give them azithromycin, we also tell them to maintain abstinence for a few days.
One thing is very, very clear from this discussion that we should always remember, because we cannot say to anyone that you should not have a sexual partner or anything. The only thing we can convey to our women for their own health, please use condom and remember when and where you can say no. Because we all know that the premarital sex is increasing. Many women, they are not marrying, they are living alone. So we have to see in the contemporary situation. We are not the modern people. We are just to advise them how to maintain their health, how to prevent the infections which can cause a sequelae and consequences to their future.
We have to teach them safe sex, basically.
Yeah. So this is a beautiful slide. Whoever want to see it, everything is there: awareness, prevention, follow up. These are 3 points which are very, very important for any vaginal infection. First thing, you have to be aware. Many of my non-medical friends, they are thinking, why we are so technical? So before having this webinar, I went to the international sites of the public education. So I was really aghast to see that how much information they are giving to their
patients.
And everything is there, from treatment, from the pathogenesis, from to this thing. Normally, when we talk to you in a public forum, we try to be very, very simple. So many a time, you are not aware of the problem. And like any disease, this vaginal discharge, polycystic ovarian disease, any disease which is has a long sequelae under, and you need a proper treatment, many a time a longer treatment, and it is a recurrent disease, until unless you understand what it is going to cause you, and how it has happened, and how can you prevent it, it is very difficult that you can prevent that problem. So considering this, we have called all the our end users or the women, for them Foxy Always Care. Foxy is our biggest society of the OBGYN in the world. It really cares for our women. We are not there only to do a practice, a medical practice, a commercial practice. We are there to teach you also. And being the vice president of Foxy and others, they are the heading many of departments. We are here to teach you in a medical term also. So when you go to your doctor, you can understand what you are suffering, and those medical jargon does not cause a problem to you. So please understand whatever your problem is, you give a chat. If you are not able to take question, we will get back to you with your email, with your number, and in your email, you will get each and every answer from us. So coming to the last, Chandan, can you take over? Last question.
Mrs. A, 30 years female, mother of 2 children, 10 years and 8 years and 2 abortions, visited gynae clinic, both deliveries normal, no contraception. She's having mild transparent discharge for 6 months, and for 4 months, she had post-coital bleeding, that is bleeding after having sex. She has already consulted 3 gynecologists and had some pessary insertion and oral medication. So Dr. Niharika, how will you approach this patient?
Ma'am, as we know that she is a young patient and she has a issue, she has already completed, she has 2 children and she's come with post-coital bleedings. The first thing I would like to take is an elaborate history of when she was married, whether early marriage was there, plus whether did she use any contraceptions, then what kind of discharge and when does the post-coital bleeding, since how long was it happening. Then a good perispectum examination, especially to see cervical causes for post-coital bleeding like erosion or a cervical polyp should be ruled out in this case. And then maybe some investigations for like a pap smear or a swab can be done.
Next, ma'am.
So we have taken the pap smear of this patient and it shows a atypical cell. Yeah, Chandan.
Yeah, next. Patient was offered further evaluation, colposcopy and biopsy, but disappeared. After 1 year, she again came and thanked profusely. She went to Tata Hospital, Mumbai. Thereafter evaluation, she was diagnosed with CA cervix stage 1B. After complete treatment, she came back to meet us. Next, ma'am. Next slide. So can I ask Dr. Anita, what is the role of probiotics in recurrent vaginal infection?
So, Dr. Chandan, as I had highlighted while telling the treatment for candidiasis, you know, vaginal flora gets disturbed whenever there is some kind of immunosuppression or patient is on corticosteroids or long use of antibiotics or is pregnant or maybe diabetic. So, in these patients, the normal vaginal flora gets disturbed. So other microorganisms which are pathological, they take over the normal lactobacilli, which are very health friendly to women. These lactobacilli, they secrete hydrogen peroxide, which doesn't let other bacteria to develop. And it maintains the vaginal acidity to be on the acidic side. So whenever there is some disturbance in vaginal pH or lactobacilli are lost, the vaginal microflora gets disturbed. So in these patients, we may sometimes need to give them, you know, microbiotics, which are the external agents. They are the, you know, therapeutic agents which can be taken orally. And when they are taken orally, there is migration of these microbiota to the vaginal epithelium, because you know, the anal canal or, you know, our anal opening is close to the vaginal opening. Mm. So these, you know, microbiomes, they migrate to the vagina replenishing the normal vaginal microflora. The symptoms does get improved. So besides giving the treatment of a particular disease, we can sometimes add on these microbiomes to these ladies for quick relief or, you know, avoiding the recurrent infections. So regarding that, we need not have, you know, all the market preparations or something like that. They say that even taking of curd or yogurt also helps, because it also helps in replenishing, you know, the normal vaginal microflora.
Thank you so much. Dr. Ragini, being in this practice of doing a lot of lasers.
Dr. Mala want to say something.
Yes, ma'am.
There are many oral probiotics are available, but nowadays vaginal probiotics
are also available. Yes, yes.
So that can also help in maintaining the normal flora.
pH. Yes. Dr. Ragini, you are into a lot of urogenital lasers for various causes. You know, then in case of recurrent infections of vagina, what lasers are available and what do you suggest for new treatments for this?
Before commenting on the laser, I just want to say two things. One thing, Niharika has brought a very nice point on the previous case, that is a cervical polyp, a small cervical polyp. So all post-coital bleeding is not only because of the cancer cervix, although this patient turned out to be the cancer cervix. And other hand, every patient should not have a vaginal discharge and a spotting should be left. Maybe it is a very, very early stage of the cancer and you can save the patient. So this is a very important case. A young 30-year-old woman having a cancer, and if biopsy, we should not be afraid of biopsy. When the patient, any doctor tell you to go for a biopsy, this is not a very invasive procedure and nobody should be afraid of it. Mm-hmm. And the second thing is the importance of the pap smear. Every single woman, after being sexually active, 3 years after the sexual activity, should have a pap smear regularly, and especially if she has a complaint, then according to the doctor. Otherwise, a regular screening every 3 years is mandatory. And after, say, attaining
35 years,
we can go with the HPV combination also, then it is 5 years. So now coming in my question, to answer to the lasers in the recurrent infection is a very, very new thing. The carbon dioxide laser, when we give in the vaginal, so especially in a perimenopausal woman or otherwise also a patient with a recurrent infection who is having a disturbed flora, less of the lactobacillus, this laser, what it causes, when we give the laser heat, it goes in the vagina, it only go up to the 4 millimeter. So it is not attaching to your rectum from where you pass the stool or the bladder from you pass the urine. It is only in the vaginal canal and it acts on the epithelium, causes the formation of the new blood vessels and new cells there. And these new cells have more of the glycogen, which is the food of the bacteria, more of the regeneration of the good bacteria that is called lactobacillus, and the cycle of the recurrent infection broken. In our practice, what we have seen with the lasers in the recurrent infection, a patient who is having taking the medicine, she is not having infection for 1 or 2 months, again coming with a bacterial infection. One thing you know, always remember that bacterial vaginosis specifically is not a sexually transmitted disease.
Yes, yes.
So here, there's no role of your partner. Otherwise also, yes, you use condom always, but with laser, this cycle breaks and patient stop having a recurrent infection because of the abnormal flora. So I'll be very short. It is a very, very big topic, but just to-
We'll take it in the next series, ma'am.
Yeah, with a very, very-
In continuity.
It's another new modality for the recurrent infections.
Infections, yes. Ma'am, I'll take 2 seconds for an announcement.
Yes.
I request all our friends to kindly support Dr. Ashok Kumar for Secretary ICOG. Our friends, Dr. Anita Rajoria for Chairperson Food and Drug Committee, POCSI, and Dr. Shashilata Kabra for Governing Council of ICOG post.
So, Thank Dr. You. Ashok, can you tell Dr. me Ashok. What are the possible pitfall for the treatment of the teleconsultation? Dr. Ashok?
Yes, madam. Teleconsultation, actually now there are some in the COVID-19, some guidelines have come from Government of India also, but as we have discussed earlier, that vaginal discharge is one of the conditions where probably we want to examine the patient, we want to see the patient physically and talk to her about some symptoms, history, and then examine the patient. Actually, without examination, we should not prescribe. So that is the problem, because by examining, by looking at the discharge and doing, as we have, I have also told earlier, by doing some simple test of or examination of the discharge under microscope or seeing the pH or gram stain, we can find out. So that opportunity when you do the telephonic diagnosis and management.
Okay.
Next slide.
So we have already discussed which new tests are available. So I'm not going in the detail. And we have already discussed what about the resource poor countries. We are syndromic
approach.
Also we have discussed. To coming to the conclusion, because we have to take few questions also. Please,
ma'am, can we have a small 1 minute or 30 second message from each one of the panelists, their take home message from all this discussion today? Sir, starting from Dr. Ashok Kumar, sir.
My take-home message is that vaginal discharge is having different causes in different age group. So one has to see the age of the patient accordingly. Like for adolescent, we have different causes. In perimenopausal women, we have to rule out malignancy first. And older women, we have to look for foreign body also. Misplaced foreign body in adolescent or young girls, sometimes foreign body is a problem, or they have multiple partners, so that type of issue. Yeah. Accordingly, in different age group, we have different types of, so that we have to keep in mind.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mala?
Vaginal discharge is a very important campaign of a patient. It should not be taken lightly. For the clinicians, sir, so told, Dr. Ashok told us, in different age groups, there are different causes. But even for gynecologists, we have to understand that sometimes if the patient is coming with persistent vaginal discharge, we have to definitely look for the cause. We have seen cases, postmenopausal patient coming with thin watery vaginal discharge. We did pap smear, it was normal. We did ultrasound, endometrial thickness was 2 millimeter. But still, she was having persistent vaginal discharge. Then on further investigating, we found that she was having a fallopian tube malignancy.
Yes, ma'am.
So, vaginal discharge can be very simple, physiological. It can be just bacterial infection, fungal infection. It can be some pre-malignant conditions also. But sometimes it can also be leading to some rare causes of malignancy. And so, vaginal discharges should be treated, investigated, very thoroughly by the doctor.
Absolutely agreed, ma'am. We had a patient, Dr. Ragini and myself operated, came with chronic discharge and turned out to be carcinoma cervix. While operating, we saw the cauliflower growth. And her repeated pap smears were normal. Next, Dr. Rajsi. Dr. Rajsi.
I would like to say that whoever patient presents with a vaginal discharge, please take a proper detailed history. And as madam had suggested in the first slide, parallel history when she is an adolescent, talking about her academics and her friends and everybody.
The heads approach, yes.
Yes. So the history taking is very important. And more important from that is the examination. Don't prescribe empirically to any patient anything, even and not an ointment, even not a tablet, even not an injection, without actually seeing for yourself and doing some basic tests.
Thank you, Dr. Shashi.
It can save us a lot of embarrassment sometimes.
Thank you so much. Yes, Dr. Shashi.
Yeah, my one very small, simple message to the non-medicals who are doing this is use condom consistently and correctly. This is very important. This will prevent a lot of infections. And say no, to, don't believe in vaginal douching and all those V-wash and other type of washes, because they will change the normal flora environment and will invite more infections.
Okay. Thank you. That is a very important message. Dr. Anita?
Yeah, I have messages for my medical friends and my non-medical friends also. So first for my medical friends, never forget 4 C's of vaginal discharge management. That is counseling. Second is condom promotion, as highlighted by Dr. Shashi, contact management and
contraception
along with compliance to treatment. Compliance is also very important.
Yes.
So just not getting the treatment written. You have to follow the advice of the doctor and comfort follower. And for my non-medical friends, I have a message, just a small couplet I have written for you. Jab de shwet pradar tanme ahat. Shwet pradar is safed pani ka aana. Jab de shwet pradar tanme ahat. Man me na karna zara bhi ghabrahat. Chuppi todo. Kaho suno aur puchho sakhi humse. Isse pani ko rahat. Thank you
so much. That's the poetess in you. And Dr. Niharika, you come with that slogan of yours, Dr. Niharika.
So I was saying that let's fight the white, because we really need to fight the white. And for all the doctors, we need to understand that India does not have a very good surveillance system for any sexually transmitted diseases. So now our focus has to be registering these cases and publishing data so that we know the impact of health burden of just a basic vaginal discharge, because it is now heading towards an epidemic as we think of it in this situation, and our focus has to be reproductively strong.
Yes. Dr. Agni?
I think we will start the question answers.
Question answers. Ma'am, first question. Shall I say? One question is, ma'am, there's a 45-year-old lady who has had a hysterectomy done 9 months back with very heavy bleeding. So, the hysterectomy must have been done for that, and since always after that she has heavy vaginal discharge. Due to this, she has to wear panty liners all the time, and it is smelly also. Kindly advise.
Dr. Ashok,
sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir, please answer that question. Post hysterectomy discharge.
One has to see if the discharge is persistent. So there are two things which I will keep in mind. One is we have to rule out her diabetes. But number two, after hysterectomy, sometimes there is a granuloma which is seen. See, when you do the speculum examination, you will see the wart, and at that area there may be a wart granuloma. So that may cause excessive vaginal discharge. So, in her, we will be not sure what type of problem she has. So,
audio is not audible.
Audible now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is important for her to be examined by a gynecologist. And speculum examination should be done to see the vault area. If there is there any raw or granuloma is there at the vault, or then one can see the type of discharge also. What type of discharge it is. And obviously, if she has candidiasis also, she can have any other problem, or it may be a misdischarge. So until unless the examination is done, it is probably not right to say anything about the diagnosis and treatment.
Thank you, sir.
Granulomas, we have seen, fallopian tubes collapsing into the vaginal wall.
Yes.
Extensive examination of patient is very, very important in these cases, as very well highlighted by Ashok, sir.
I just want to add one more.
Should ask one or two hands which are raised. Deepika, yes, yes. I will say unmute Mrs. Vijay Lakshmi Attuappal Raman. She has joined from the south. I think if she is there, unmute her and allow to talk her. We should also want to know the direct question from the patients.
Ma'am, then one question is that in the first case, the girl is a minor. Should one take mother's consent before pelvic examination? Yes, mother's, the parents' consent has to be there for the minor children. Yes, definitely. And if she's a 17-year-old girl, and will you inform the police under POXO Act? Yes, definitely. If she is having sexual intercourse, yes, definitely you have to inform the police.
I just want to say that patient, a 16-year-old patient can give consent for examination.
Yes, those are called as the adolescent consents. Yes, after 16.
Intervention, her parents.
For the examination, yes. Yeah. Beyond 16, these are called as adult adolescent consents.
Mrs. Vijayalakshmi is not there. Next, we have Yash Bhagra. Yash Bhagra.
Dr. Kiran is unmuted. Maybe Dr. Kiran can speak because the hand was raised. Dr. Kiran Vinayak.
I want to know about boric acid capsules. Boric acid capsules. How they are available and how they are used.
They were used previously. Definitely. But now we have better options available, so it is easier options we can give to the patient. Boric acid capsule was used in complicated candidiasis like recurrent vaginal candidiasis.
Still, it is not easily available.
Dr. Ragni, one patient is asking about if the adolescents are not sexually active. They are not sexually active, but they are having discharge per vagina. So how to manage them?
If they are not sexually active and having a per vaginal examination, again, patient's examination is very necessary because two things. Maybe it is just a UTI or
she's causing. She might be hiding the history also. Infection,
or there is some sexual abuse.
Yes, yes.
Which is, she's not important. Talking to you. The examination is
she very. She might be hiding.
Necessary. Then the third thing which I found is, many a time they are nutritionally deficient. They are not maintaining proper hygiene. That is also a reason of a non-sexual infections. So examination is must in each and every case, whether the girl is sexually active or not. Many a time when you examine these young girls, say 7-8 years even old girl, and they are really, really at that time, very painful to know they are sexually abused by someone in the family only. So persistent and discharge one should be always take in young girls very seriously.
So Dr. Rajasi, can you answer one question?
Can I just add to this also if you don't mind?
No.
Yes, we never mind anything, please.
Actually, whatever Ragini ma'am said, perfect list. I would just add, in adolescent girls, we should also look out for certain foreign bodies.
Sex toys.
Yes, please.
Sex toys.
I was coming to that.
Yeah. Because internet influence is there. So yes. We have to rule out that. One important question is that somebody says that if somebody is using a copper tea, and she has discharged, should we remove the copper tea? Very good question.
Not really, and not always.
Yeah.
Unless the copper tea has been shown to be the incriminating factor.
Yeah.
Like it is
misplaced. The guideline also says, the RCOG guideline. Dr. Shashi, you want to add something?
Yeah, copper tea as such is not an indication for removal in a case of single episode of vaginal discharge. We should examine the patient thoroughly. Paraspeculum and external examination, and paraspeculum according to discharges, if whatever is there, we should provide treatment. And if it is indicated for the contact, we should also advise the contact. Rather, we should reassure the patient that it will go and it will pass by single therapy.
Yeah. So Dr. Nihar, thank you so much.
And then please, we have unmuted three people. Let them ask the question.
Sure.
Please, Deepika.
Dr. Vijay Kumari.
Yes.
You can ask your question.
But meanwhile, can we have one question, please? How frequently
Okay.
Vijay Kumari, if you would like to ask, you can speak now.
Small girls, 6 years or 7 years, they are coming with redness of the vagina and itching and painful discharge. What can we do?
Yeah, deworming would be an important point.
Well, first of all, we have to rule out the sexual assault in that.
Yeah.
Most important. Never suspicion has to be there. There is a redness anywhere. We have to rule out the sexual.
For androgynous.
Total examination should be done for this case.
And absolutely.
Plus, sometimes concentrated urine also does that to very small girls.
And you have to maybe the mother.
Itching and all
drink a lot of water.
Personal hygiene is very important.
Dr. Niharika,
mother also.
There is a question, how frequently one should empty the menstrual cup?
A menstrual cup can be kept for as long as almost 12 hours. But ideally, we suggest that you should empty it after 10 hours because if it gets overfull, then it gets difficult to remove. So that's why we usually say 8 to 10 hours is enough.
Ma'am, Dr. Ragini, there is a question. What is the approach for a patient with vulvar dermatitis?
So if a patient is having a vulvar dermatitis, it's a very different what we are seeing for the vaginitis. Those patients of the vulvar dermatosis has some other reasons also, like lichen planus, lichen sclerosis, they can have a wart, a molluscum, or there's something called neurological itching. And that patient, initially they have some infection, and when infection goes, but their itching is persisted like a signal in their mind, and continuous itching lead to a thickening of the membrane, and this is called a vulvar dermatosis of the neurological origin. Mm-hmm. So these are the many things when we think of the vulvar dermatitis or vulvar itching. So a complete panel of the vulvar dermatosis should be excluded.
Yes.
And if my gynecologist friend is not very well versed for the vulvar dermatosis, it is better to take the help of a dermatological colleague also. And
Doctor,
in the when patient is coming for a vulvar dermatosis and not responding to your treatment, many a time it is a sign of a early cancer also, vulval cancer, especially when the patient is of the elderly. Biopsy is always needed. Never hesitant to take a biopsy. Take a biopsy, reach to a diagnosis. Because skin is very different from the vaginal mucosa, and treat properly according to the diagnosis.
Dr. Mala, a question for you. Should external genitalia be cleaned in a specific way to avoid vaginal infections?
Normally, when we examine the patient, and then we want to clean the vulva with a cotton swab soaked in saline before behind, right from the upper to lower part. So that we do not contaminate the perineal region to the other side. So that is the vagina, if you want vulva, from before and behind. I mean, upper se niche tak hum
yes.
That's the way we clean it. From above and
behind. So toilets, jin toilet piche se hota hai dhone ka, that should be removed.
Yes.
Dr. Chandam?
Yeah.
There is one question by doctors about treatment of recurrent bacterial vaginosis and recurrent vaginitis. So can I answer?
Yes, you can. Please.
See, for recurrent bacterial vaginosis, we can give metronidazole gel 1.75% twice daily for 4 to 6 months. And then we can also use monthly metronidazole 2 gram orally. And we can add fluconazole along with this. CDC guidelines says that this helps in treating persistent bacterial vaginosis. And as earlier said, even if boric acid is available, then 600 milligram of boric acid can also be used for 21 days intravaginally. And for a persistent trichomoniasis, we can use a higher dose of tinidazole, 2 to 3 gram for 14 days.
And please rule out underlying situations like diabetes, conditions like
rule out all those.
Make this patient prone,
This is a very nice question. Can pinworm cause vaginal discharge?
Yes.
In fact, in young girls, I always
think young girls, very, very, very common. We have seen pinworms in the vagina.
You want to listen any other
very nice question. Ma'am, very nice question. Is that necessary to remove public pubic hair completely regularly, or just trimming is enough?
No.
Ideally, pubic hair should not be removed because
trimming is okay.
Enough. Yes. Use a razor if at all.
There is so much in internet that they know it very well. And one more thing, I advise to my young girls, those who are less than 10 years, 12 years, that you wear a cotton panty, or better, you press it.
Ma'am, somebody is asking post hysterectomy.
Okay, regarding just one. Regarding pinworm, it is very important to cause for itching and excessive crying in the young child, in children, small ones, and excessive crying or vulval itching repeatedly.
Yes, yes.
So if you just separate the external labia, genitalia, or the anal area, perineal area, you will see pinworms moving here and
itching,
there.
Itching.
So very, very typical presentation.
Sir,
so
in the night time,
in children.
The night time, the itching is more. I think that is the symptom. Dr. Ashok, there is a question for you. How to treat post-hysterectomy granulation?
Just a minute. In continuation with Dr. Shashi's message, I just want to convey that we must educate our adolescent girls and young daughters to let their undergarments dry in sun.
Yes.
That is very, very important.
And avoid
the easy method, you know?
And avoid those fragrant soaps and all.
Yeah.
Dr. Ashok, there is a question for you, sir. How to treat post-hysterectomy granulation with discharge, granulation tissue? Dr. Ashok, sir?
What is the question?
Sir, post-hysterectomy granulation, granulomas.
They are not granulomas.
Granulation tissue, this is.
Granulation tissue. It has been seen that because of impacting of the vault, vaginal vault, after surgery, sometimes raw area or granulation tissue develops at the angle of the vagina or in that area, in the vault. So it is just present symptoms of discharge, or sometimes bleeding also. But you have to just treat with antibiotics, and if it is going, then one can cauterize that area.
Oh yes, cauterization. Sir, if somebody's husband is having balanitis and the patient herself is asymptomatic, does she need any treatment?
Yeah, as per principle of contact treatment, she should get.
Yes. Use condom.
You have to treat the partners also. All active partners are to be treated.
I think we have answered many questions. Deepika, is there anything else?
Is there anybody with their raised hand?
Ma'am, there are some hands raised.
Yes, please.
Could ask Dr. Nirmala Yadav. You could unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes.
Please unmute first. Then we ask Dr. Monica Goel to unmute and ask. And then we have Dr. Deepa Kapoor and Dr. Jyotsna Gupta. Please unmute and then you can ask your question.
We had more than 478 participants today. That's a huge crowd. Congratulations, Deepika.
Uh-huh. There must have been more, ma'am. And then we are
about 500 live. It's a conference.
Hello.
Yeah, Dr. Joseph.
Yeah, this is I just want to know that at what age the V wash can be advised to any girl.
Why are you using?
Because there was in the chat there was an answer that V wash can be used.
No, that's why I'm not advising it. We have said that it should not be used.
Any kind of chemical should not be used because they may themselves cause
damage.
pH change.
Right. Thank you.
Next question.
Dr. Krishna Batra, Dr. Ganga Raju, you can unmute and ask your question. Dr. Monica Goel.
Hello, ma'am. Good evening. Ma'am, in case of vulvar dermatitis, you said you have to take biopsy. And can you kindly tell us from which area the biopsy has to be taken in the vulval area?
Ragni.
where the patient is having a most of the itching, you feel the thickness in the, you know, just I'll give an example. Like a patient of lichen sclerosis when comes to you, in early stage there's not a very very clear demarcated shrinkage or anything, but if you see that area very minutely, the color is little bit changed, the texture of the membrane, the texture of the skin is changed, it is dry, it is little tough, and from that area you can take the biopsy by a dermal punch. Dermal punch is a very very small caliber and very easy to take, no stitches is even being put after that. And you send that biopsy, and especially the dermal biopsy should be sent to a pathologist who is trained into the skin disease pathology. It is always, if you send to a general pathologist, you will not get your answers.
So, and can we take the biopsy, ma'am, with a knife?
You can take knife, but the knife is more elaborate. You have to take give lots invasive. Of infiltration, and then you put a stitch, then you have
Okay.
And especially if you are not very comfortable, if you are not very sure,
dermatologist.
Send to a dermatologist. Why? I can answer this question very easily. I am surrounded with a team dermatologist.
That's why specifically I asked you this question. Dr. Ashok, sir, there is a question, treatment for persistent vulval itching without any discharge in elderly patients.
In elderly women, see, there are two things which we have to be careful. One is itching may be because of atrophy. It may be because of menopause, postmenopausal. And second is we should not rule out vulval dystrophies or some vulval lesions. So one has to investigate these cases carefully.
So diabetes also can be investigated?
Yes. Diabetes will have discharge. Candidiasis and they will have discharge, but without discharge, itching, local area, one has to be very careful, because see, the basis in old age, one has to be careful about malignancy. So we have to be rather more suspicious in this age group.
There's a nice question in the box, that in case of balanitis, which antibiotic for how long should be given? It's a wonderful question. In this era of practice, we should learn a multidisciplinary approach and when to refer our patient to our fellow doctors. It is very, very important.
Not able to hear, ma'am.
To me? Hello?
Yeah. Hello?
Ma'am, the audio is not good, ma'am.
Now it is. Now you are able to listen?
Yes.
Now.
So what I'm saying about the balanitis question, that it is a we should think of referring that patient to the appropriate doctor. Balanitis is never come in our purview, and we should refer this patient to male health specialist, either dermatologist or andrologist, or if they are not available in your place, to a general surgeon. I will never advise to treat this balanitis by yourself, because it can lead to a serious condition. And genital conditions can cause a great impact on the patient's quality of life, her mental status, and everything. Next question,
Kajana. Ma'am, cervical erosions are there, multiple. If somebody has cervical erosions and discharge, we should advise them cryopottery for that. So certain people are asking, should we advise cryopottery and when?
After this, Deepa Kapoor and Ganga Raju, two people will talk directly. Yeah,
anybody can answer this question.
Cervical erosion, you have to, take pap smear. Ideally, you should give a course of antibiotics, take her pap smear, and if everything is all right, there are no atypical cells in pap smear, then you can go ahead with cryocautery. And then ask the patient to wait for 6 weeks. She will be cured, and then you can do the follow-up of the patient. Should not do cryocautery without properly investigating the erosion. And
Do a colposcopy before doing
that? If you find any typical cells or agars or abscess, then If the need be, then you need to do the colposcopy.
Today, if you don't have a colposcopy, you can at least do the VIA in the OPD.
Definitely. Yeah.
VIA is very important.
Where's your comment on it?
Yes.
I just want to add one thing. Yes. That cryocautery itself leads to use profuse watery discharge.
Yes.
So you have to wait for 6 weeks then.
Yes.
You have to advise that the post-cautery patient will experience a lot of vaginal discharge and she should not worry. There may be spotting also at times. You have to really counsel the patient and ask her to come for follow.
Somebody is asking about herpes genitalis painful vaginal discharge. How to treat that?
So it is a viral, viral infection. It has to be treated with acyclovir or ganciclovir regime.
Dr. Ganga Raju?
Yes. Yes. Are you able to hear me, ma'am?
Yes.
Congratulations, Dr. Ragini Agarwal and your team for your illustrious discussions on this vaginal discharge. The thing is, which I learned is about the carbon dioxide laser for the recurrent vaginal discharge. That is a new point and how frequently it can be repeated and what are the precautions you take?
So the when we use the laser, the first thing, patient should not be having an active infection. So the when the patient comes to me, I always go for a vaginal smear, a pap smear, rule out.
Yes, after working up the patient only.
Pardon?
After working up the patient only.
Working, when we do the this laser, this is monthly session for 3 months. And then we leave it. And only if patient comes again. In my practice, I have done 20 patients for this particular problem. And out of this 20 patients, 16 patients are not had any big episode of the infection. They don't need any laser treatment or anything. 3 of the patient, they are having a comorbidities like things. So they are also maintained with the treatment only. Repeat laser session, I was not given to any of these patients. The only first session, I have laser last 2 years only, so I can't say I have a very big study. So in 2 years, those patients who have taken a course, they have never came back to me for this.
Yeah, this is a new study in our setting. That's why I asked you. And best wishes and congratulations for the team for contesting, ma'am. I'm Dr. Saumini. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think, ma'am, almost all the questions have been answered.
Anybody wants to ask any question or because it's still 244 people are there. Any other question?
Carbon dioxide laser.
Yeah.
How many of us are doing VIF test in the OPDs?
Yeah.
Anybody doing VIF test in the OPD?
VIF test is rarely, we are rarely doing history.
History
give you, the patient will complain of fishy odor after sexual intercourse. Because semen is also alkaline. So if there is any doubt about it, after sexual intercourse, patient will tell that there is a typical smell which she experiences after sexual intercourse. Uh-huh. So it's like an indirect evidence.
Gotcha. It is a very nice.
It is a very easy test to do, actually.
One very nice question has come up that just like females, some intimate products are also available for males. So is it harmful for both of them, the male using the intimate product? Anybody?
Yes, I think in the longer run, any of these commercial and over-the-counter products will create some problem or the other for either partner. So better to avoid its regular use.
There is a scientific evidence to it because whatever chemical you are using, the normal colonizers of skin will get disturbed.
Yes.
So why to unnecessarily play with nature, So better to
something about nanosilver.
We can't hear anything now.
Yeah, audio is not clear. Audio is not clear. Yeah. So we could go to Dr. Monica Goyal, Dr. Deepa Kapoor. Anybody wants to ask? Prakriti Agarwal.
It will be nice if we can see our audience also. The one who is asking the questions.
Well, mostly the patients are using a lot of Betnovate and like steroid combination for itching in the vagina. Is it recommended?
Not to be recommended. Unless yes. You diagnose
the steroid self-medication should not be done. It can be more harmful to because we have seen a lot of secondary infections coming up because of this steroid combination creams used. This was one question asked by somebody. So anybody was using nano silver gel?
Not advisable, not indicated anywhere.
We haven't used it.
We've never used
it on any patient. It is a very good moisturizer, yes. If I can
what
say.
What is the role of nano silver gel?
Nano silver, we are not using, ma'am.
I will tell you where I have used. It is a very good moisturizer, especially in cases of the vulval dryness and the vulval dermatosis. And what I talked to you about the neurological vulval dermatosis, when patient there's a thickening, there's a dryness. To just make it moisturize, either you have to prescribe some Vaseline or some other moisturizer. In those cases, I have used this gel. And this gel is really act as a good moisturizer. If I say patient is having a candidiasis or trichomoniasis and I use this gel, then it is not a good thing. Because we have always seen for which problem we are treating. That is very important. So instead of a Vaseline or something, which I am not very sure, I have used this thing and I found the result. I have not used in clear-cut cases of the infections.
But no self-medication should be done.
You are becoming a derma expert, ma'am, surrounded by...
Dr. Niharika, for you, question. Should external genitalia be cleaned with water every time after passing urine? Is this a good practice?
Yes. See, even if you're cleaning it every time with water, you have to keep it dry after
dry,
that.
Dry.
You don't have to leave it wet. Because once you leave it wet, it will cause infections.
Yes, I agree.
Actually, there is no need to...
Yes.
Yeah. Natural moisture is good. Dr. Anita, you are for that?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that there is no need to repeatedly wash it after every urination. And it is very well highlighted by Niharika that the vulva should be kept dry.
Dry. I think we have answered all the questions. Anybody who wants to ask anything in the audience can raise hand. 5 participants have raised hand. Deepika, can you find out?
So whenever we find, whenever we find opportunity, we must counsel our patients regarding menstrual hygiene, contraception, and their personal hygiene of local area.
And safe sex.
Yeah.
That is most
important. Now we are also not talking about good touch or bad touch. We are talking about safe touch.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, Neha.
Hello. Good evening, ma'am. Ma'am, I want to ask you that you always have recommended uses of condoms. But nowadays, yes. Condoms are also having so many chemicals for sensation or other purposes. So is it safe for using condoms every time?
I can take that question. If, a lady gets irritation after use of a particular brand, then she can change it over to some other one. So you can always try it with another brand. So it may not be that all the condoms will cause problem in her case. So she can always use a different brand next time.
But it is better to use a brand which does not have a fragrance, because it is found that most of the fragrance can cause the vaginitis or irritation on the private part. even we should not use lots of other DO or fragrant thing on the private part. It is not advisable. Even not the fragrant soap should be used on the private part.
And condoms distributed by the government of India in all government hospitals are very good. They are without any spermicidal jelly and without any fragrance or anything.
Yeah, Sachi.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Ma'am, what is the cause of thick transparent vaginal discharge which is coming from cervical os? Patient has taken many time from many different doctors but not responded. What is the cause of thick vaginal discharge mostly coming from cervical os? What is the cause and treatment? Please tell me.
Just like one cause, we cannot say this cause is because I want to evaluate, especially the endocervical canal in this patient.
Yes,
if a thick discharge is coming out, whether your endocervical canal has been evaluated or not, the smear, a pap smear is taken from the endocervical canal or not, this is very important. What type of culture has done, whether this culture is only aerobic, anaerobic, for chlamydia, everything has to be first taken in consideration, and what treatment you have taken, how long you have taken. So this is very important. To just to buy a symptom, I can't say that you are suffering from this particular problem.
It may be a physiological discharge, ma'am. It may be a physiological
discharge.
You can't forget ovulation cascade, as you were taught in undergraduate classes, that during peri-ovulatory phase, there is lot of excessive discharge. And then you cannot, you have to evaluate endocervical canal and endometrial cavity also, because sometimes small endometrial polyps, they may just present with excessive discharge. May not be any bleeding. So evaluation of patient is at most in these kinds of situations.
You have to subject this discharge to different types of batteries of tests.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. My question is, patient after intercourse ke baad kya kare unko infection ho, safe intercourse ho, bahut se condom istemal nahi karte hain, to kya ke humse Dettol se wash kar le, one drop or fir kya advice kare, that means matlab kuch multi aise kuch tube jisme sab kuch ho, bactericidal bhi ho aur bhi ho, antibactericidal bhi ho, matlab after intercourse wo kya safai kare, matlab kya precaution,
condom use kare?
कंडोम नहीं यूज करते बहुत से पेशेंट्स, उनको नहीं पता
करना चाहिए अगर उनको इस किस्म की प्रॉब्लम है, इट इज बेटर टू यूज कंडोम देन यूजिंग एनी केमिकल ऑन द प्राइवेट पार्ट. यू इफ यू वॉश वांट टू यू वॉश योरसेल्फ, ओनली द ल्यूकोम वाटर इज इनफ.
कोई भी क्रीम,
नो केमिकल्स,
कोई क्रीम यूज नहीं करनी चाहिए. सेल्फ मेडिकेशन इज नॉट रिकमेंडेड.
एक और बहुत अच्छी टिप मैं अपनी महिलाओं को बताना चाहूंगी कि आफ्टर सेक्सुअल इंटरकोर्स, it is better that go and pass urine if they have symptoms of recurrent urinary tract infection. Agar aapko baar baar peshab mein jalan ho rahi hai ya aise koi symptom ho rahe hain, to better hai ki after sexual intercourse aap pehle aur baad mein sexual intercourse ke urine pass karte hain.
एक चीज और है कि हम लोग सिर्फ लेडीज के इन्फेक्शन की बात कर रहे हैं, उनके टेस्टिंग करा रहे हैं. अगर रिकरेंट इन्फेक्शन हो रहा है तो इट इज इम्पोर्टेंट दैट पार्टनर का भी यूरिन और सीमेन का इन्फेक्शन चेक होना चाहिए. एक और बात हम यहाँ पर भूल रहे हैं, मेनी अ टाइम दीज परसिस्टेंट इन्फेक्शंस इन आवर इंडियन कंटेक्स्ट इज बिकॉज ऑफ द ट्यूबरकुलोसिस, नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ द क्लेमाइडिया और अदर थिंग्स. सो दीज टेस्ट ऑल्सो इज इन द आवर आर्मामेटेरियम. अगर ऐसा कुछ प्रॉब्लम आपको लग रहा है ना, इट इज यू नीड अ डिटेल इवेल्युएशन with a doctor, with a partner treatment also. I think we should wind up now. Thank you so much everyone, my panelists, my friends who have logged in, and my all panelists who are here, they have done wonderful work. And I thank Jackson Paul who has agreed to do this webinar, not only for doctors, for the society also. And we are coming with it's a continuation series. On 8th of July, we are coming with another common problem. And I request you all to send, if you want something especially to be discussed, and what you not found good in this discussion, how we can improve it more and more. And we will be with you on 8th July again. Thank you very much. And I want to thank my parent body, FOCSI, which has given us a light to be with the all the time, to care the woman passionately and compassion, with compassion. And always, we are always with you to teach you and to go towards, to make the woman healthy and happy. Stay safe, stay fit. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I would like to take you 1 minute.
Thank you.
I'd like to take 1 minute to thank all our experts who are here today for taking out your valuable time and sharing vast knowledge with all of us today. On behalf of Jackson Pal, who are the makers of doxycycline 100 mg as Doxypal DRL, and also Verena Vaginal Gel, I and my teammates, Dr. Vipin Tyagi and Mr. Amit Saxena, we all of us really thank all the experts and all the attendees here today for your unending support. And till we see you next time in the next series of Dr. Ragini Agarwal, it is a bye from us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Such a hard work.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye, friends.